Now, moving on to our next panel, here comes the poll. Request you all once again to participate. The results, please. Percent. Sure. Our third topic, challenges and caregivers during COVID and beyond. Our moderator for this panel is Ms. Sutapa Biswas from Kolkata. She is the executive director of Cancer Foundation. And our panel members, we have Mr. Chandu Parab, Head of Department Medical Social Worker at Tata Memorial Hospital, Dr. Vinay Deshmalogist at Sandy Hospital, Ms. Shalini Jatia, Secretary Impact Foundation at Tata Memorial Hospital, and Mr. Sanjeev Sharma, Patient Advocate and a COVID Warrior.
Well, good evening, everybody. On behalf of WeCare Foundation and on the occasion of Survivors Day, it's an honor that we have a panel which is going to talk today on the challenges of cancer patients and caregivers during COVID and beyond. Well, this was an extraordinary health crisis. So definitely an extraordinary situation arose and we all came up with extraordinary measures. So today what we have here is a group of real people who took the challenge head on. And it's a wonderful experience for me to introduce Mr. Sanjeev Sharma, who is a COVID warrior himself and a volunteer at the Tata Memorial Hospital. We have Ms. Shalini Jatia, who is the secretary of the Impact Foundation, which is the pediatric foundation of the Tata Memorial Hospital, and they support children in the hospital. We have Dr. Vinay Deshmani, the eminent surgical oncologist with the PD Hinduja Hospital and the Breach Candy Hospital, and he is very, very active with the Indian Cancer Society in Mumbai. And of course, Mr. Chandu Parab, who is the head of the Department of Medical Social Work at the Tata Memorial Hospital in Mumbai. What we have seen during the COVID times, I think none of us were prepared for that. Whatever level we were working in, none of us knew what was coming, and no one knew it's going to go on till, it's almost a year now, till this point. So it has been an extraordinary situation, as I said, and all of us tried to find what best could be done. So to start with, you know, Sanjeev ji, if we can know what it is like to get COVID and what it is like to come out of it, experience it. What was the experience? That is what I think you'd want to start with.
Okay. Thank you, Sudatta ji. सबसे पहले अगर हम बोले COVID, तो जब हम COVID के लिए शुरुआत हुआ था और टाटा मेमोरियल में जब वॉलेंटियर काम करने के लिए जा रहे थे, सो माइंड में ऐसा था कि मुझे तो कोविड हो ही नहीं सकता है, सो एंड होगा भी तो पता नहीं चलेगा. बट जब पता चला कि फर्स्ट टेस्ट इनकनक्लूसिव है, सेकेंड भी इनकनक्लूसिव है, देन मैडम ने बोली कि नहीं आप पॉजिटिव हो, सो वो एक्सेप्ट करने के लिए तैयार ही नहीं था मैं, क्योंकि अगर हम घर पे बैठ जाएंगे तो जो अभी ये मौका मिला है काम करने के लिए पेशेंट लोगों के लिए, वो शायद मिस हो जाएगा. तो सबसे बड़ा मन में वो बात था कि हमें कोई भी हालत में करना है. एंड जब मुझे क्वारंटाइन होना था तो जो हमारे कोलीग थे उनको मैं इतना ए हो गया था कि मैं बोल रहा था अगर मैं क्वारंटाइन होऊंगा तो मैं फिर कुछ भी काम नहीं करूंगा. मुझे बिल्कुल इसके लिए बोल रहे थे कि मुझे क्वारंटाइन नहीं होना था, मुझे लोगों के लिए करना था, इस वजह से हमें बात बोल रहे थे. बट थ्रू आउट जब हुआ उसके बाद क्वारंटाइन होने के बाद भी हमारा वर्क चालू रहा, एंड हम ये बोल सकते हैं कि कुछ चीज़ें जो फिजिकली लग रहा था करेंगे वो हम फिजिकली नहीं करके फिर हम ऑनलाइन, जैसे जूम कॉल है एंड फोन कॉल, फिर ऐसा लगा कि नहीं आप कहीं पे नहीं प्रेजेंट रह के भी आप बहुत सारे काम कर सकते हो, एंड वो हमने किया. और अच्छा लगा कि इन बिटवीन लोगों से जुड़े रह के काम करके भी ये सारी चीज़ें, और इसमें हम लोगों ने एक काम भी स्टार्ट किया जो कि पेशेंट के लिए था, कि कैसे बहुत सारे जब प्रॉब्लम हो रहे थे जब हम लोग शुरुआत किए थे कि पेशेंट आ रहे थे और जब हम लोग सारे लोग शालिनी जी परब सर ज्योति एंड वंदना मैम हम सब लोग गेट पे जाते थे और जब पेशेंट को बोलते थे कि अभी आप चले जाइए खास के जो फॉलोअप वाले पेशेंट हैं एंड जो ट्रीटमेंट है उनको देखेंगे आप फॉलोअप कुछ दिन बाद भी आके कर सकते थे वो टाइम वो उनका इतना बोलना होता था कि नहीं नहीं आपने बुलाया है हम जाएंगे ही नहीं सो उनको कन्विंस करना बहुत मुश्किल हो रहा था उनको समझाना ये चीज़ कि ये नया चीज़ है बिल्कुल नया था तो हम लोगों को भी पता नहीं था खास के कि कैसे उनको कन्विंस करना है और बताना है और यही चीज़ लग रहा था कि नहीं मुझे करना है लेकिन जब क्वारंटाइन होंगे तो नहीं करना है लेकिन फिर उसके बाद हम लोगों ने ऑनलाइन प्लेटफॉर्म चालू किया खास के पेशेंट लोगों के और फिर जो भी उनका प्रॉब्लम था जैसे मेडिसिन के प्रॉब्लम थे उनके पहुंच नहीं पा रहे थे डॉक्टर से कैसे बात करें नहीं कर पा रहे थे फिर डॉक्टर का टीम डायटिशियन का टीम सोशल वर्कर का टीम वॉलंटियर का टीम जो भी है फिर हम लोगों ने ऑनलाइन उनसे करना तो एक तरह से ऐसा जर्नी था वो क्वारंटाइन जब हम पॉजिटिव थे उसके बीच का
तो आप जब आपका डायग्नोज हुआ तो आप तो सोच रहे थे आपको होने वाला है नहीं
Yes,
बिल्कुल. आपको कैसे लगा कि आपको टेस्ट कराना है क्यों गए थे टेस्ट कराने आपको तो होना ही
टेस्ट कराने के लिए एक कॉन्टेक्ट ट्रेसिंग था कि जो हमारे एक कोलिग थे वो पॉजिटिव हुए थे तो उसमें कॉन्टेक्ट ट्रेसिंग था उसमें से टेस्ट कराना पड़ा और फिर इनकनक्लूसिव हुआ था
चलिए अगर मान लीजिए कि आपका पॉजिटिव था तो आप क्वारंटाइन में चले गए आपका मन तो कर नहीं रहा था व्हाट यू सेड कि आपका बिल्कुल भी मन नहीं था कि आप छोड़ छाड़ के क्वारंटाइन हो जाए
Yes, तो बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
तो उसमें जब आपको रोक दिया गया कि 15 दिन का how many days
15 days एंड 15 days के बाद 7 days फिर एक टेस्ट के लिए होता है तो ऑलमोस्ट 21 days
हाँ तो चलिए महीना भर यू आर आउट ऑफ एक्शन सो टू से जो आप कह रहे हैं ना एक्शन जहाँ पे चल रहा था वहां पे आप थे नहीं और रह नहीं पा रहे थे दैट इज व्हाट यू डिड नॉट लाइक कि जहाँ पे गोली चल रही है वहां आप नहीं थे तो जब आप वापस आए तो क्या एक्स्ट्रा एनर्जी थी आपकी ज्यादा कर ले
एक्चुअली यही तो नया चीज सीखने को मिला है कि पहले लग रहा था कि हम सिर्फ वहां पर रह के ही काम कर सकते हैं ये सिखा दिया कोरोना कि नहीं आप पीछे से भी काम कर सकते हो तो ये एक बहुत बड़ा अगर सीख इस चीजों से मिला हाँ उसके बाद दोबारा जाने के बाद फिर इजी हो गया मतलब कि अब हो गया है तो चलो दोबारा नहीं होगा तो एक और
अच्छा
ये आ गया कि एंटीबॉडी डेवलप हो गया तो और भी थोड़ा सा डर खत्म हो गया
तो कुछ नए नए वर्ड्स भी तो सीखे ना क्वारंटाइन सीखे एंटीबॉडी सीख लिए जो पहले नहीं था ना एंटीबॉडी सीख लिए इन्फेक्शन अब हमें नहीं होगा एक बार जब हो गया है और क्या क्या नई जूम सीख लिए और क्या नई चीज आप सीख के आगे जा रहे हैं
नया तो एक अगर सबसे बात बोले कि हाँ कोरोना ये सब नए वर्ड थे और अगर सीखने की बात करें तो कैसे बीइंग प्रेजेंट अगर हम कहीं रह के नहीं रहते हुए भी हम कैसे काम कर सकते हैं और लोगों से कैसे करवा सकते हैं ये चीजें सीखने को मिला है
कि चलिए कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग हो गई आपकी जी, एक ट्रेनिंग हो गई पूरी थ्रू द कोविड टाइम एंड द वॉलंटियरिंग एक्सपीरियंस दैट यू हैड सो अच्छा है विल हियर मोर अबाउट अदर एक्सपीरियंसेस आई वांट टू हियर कि बच्चों का क्या हुआ यू नो ड्यूरिंग दिस टाइम जो बड़े होते हैं दे अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट दे आर गोइंग थ्रू सो कंपैरेटिवली थोड़े बेटर है कि अच्छा ये सिचुएशन आई है नोबडी न्यू कि ऐसा कुछ हो सकता है सो हाउ डिड द चिल्ड्रन रिएक्ट टू इट सो आई वुड वांट टू नो फ्रॉम शालिनी जी दैट मेनी चिल्ड्रन वर इन द मिडल ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट सो व्हाट हैपेंड टू देम How did they cope or their parents cope with it?
Sure. So thank you for having me here, Sutapa. And I would like to discuss this in two different groups. So one group is the children who were already in Mumbai taking treatment at the Tata Memorial Hospital. So we have at any given time almost 300, 400 children who are here on treatment. And all these children are staying in accommodation centers, which are provided by the hospital. Some are free, some are subsidized, and some are paid for. So initially when COVID came in March, the first situation was one of extreme panic. So when there was a child in one accommodation center who would be positive with COVID, that entire accommodation center was under lockdown. So basically it led to locking down most of the accommodation centers, 90% of the accommodation centers. And there were some accommodation centers where children were in cubicles. So if suppose there was one child who had COVID, we could still manage the other children in the other cubicles. But most of the accommodation centers are dormitory style, where if you have one child who's had COVID, so then 12, 15 on that floor will all have to be quarantined. Their parents have to be tested. And this was the situation for the first couple of months. And in that, what we did is, what the hospital in fact did is that we asked all children to stop coming to the hospital, and we were staggering the appointments. So children who were on chemotherapy, making sure that the center is not under lockdown, they were being called for their specific appointments. Children who needed any emergency help were being called. Their transport was being arranged by the hospital, and most of the children were being asked to stay back at the accommodation centers. And here at the hospital also, we had a separate ward made just for COVID positive patients, and we were allowing the parents to stay back with the children. So even that management was happening simultaneously. Now, while this was happening, the biggest challenge was, apart from treatment, the food. That if the accommodation centers are under lockdown, how do we provide food to all the centers? How do we provide food to the children in the hospital? Here, all the NGOs have played a fabulous, wonderful role for us. So they were not just helping the children and their parents, but they were also helping the staff of the hospital, the security of the hospital, and NGOs have gone out of the way to make sure that nobody remains hungry during these months. Then all the protective gear that we needed, the PPEs, the masks, the sanitizers, again, a lot of help has come not from the government, but also from the NGO space. So all our corporate partners have reached out, all the NGOs have reached out, and they have been very, very helpful in making sure that we get all the equipments that we need in order to provide quality care to all the patients, to all the relatives, to make sure that they're, you know, wearing masks, they're managing their hand sanitization. And also we've had a separate fever OPD made in the hospital for patients who are coming in who had to be screened for COVID. Even there we needed a lot of extra hands. So again, there we've had support from volunteers across and from NGOs across. So the first few months was about this. Now the second group of children who were due for their treatment and who were not able to travel because of the lockdown imposed by the government, that had been very challenging for us initially, because that led to a lot of children not reaching the hospital on time. It led to delays in them getting treatment. And in fact, we were collecting data all these months, and what we realized at the end of 2020 was that it has led to a lot of children abandoning treatment. It has led to a lot of children coming late, new cases coming in late. It has also led to children who've gone for short breaks who have not come back at all. So we are still figuring out the exact numbers, but it has been challenging and trying, and the numbers have not been as they were the years previous to the pandemic. So that.
And how did the children react to it? You know, what was the children wearing masks, you know, using sanitizers? These are new for the children. You know, for adults, it is difficult. But I was just thinking, you know, how did the children cope with it? What has been your experience with kids, you know?
So it's been difficult to do social distancing in the hospital because of the sheer numbers. However, everybody has been advised to use masks. Children have been very happy wearing masks. And we've had a lot of NGOs who's provided us with masks with all these, characters made on them and all these different colors. So this has led to children being very happy about wearing the mask. And hand sanitizers also, they've been very happy to use. So we've had corporates giving us those big and small bottles, and everybody's been, you know, using it liberally, and everybody has it. So we've given ample stocks to all the families. So that hasn't been an issue for us. It's worked very well.
But those in the middle of treatment, did they have to go back? I mean, they vacated the hospital. What happened to those in the middle of treatment?
So on an average, a child needs to be in Mumbai for a period of almost 6 months to 1.5 years for cancer treatment. And all the children who were here, we made sure that they are all continuing with treatment. And even the new cases who would have ideally come in March, April and May, they did not come that quarter. But after June, July, everyone started coming in. And today where we stand, our numbers are all back to almost normal, even with the old cases and even with the new cases.
Did they use the telecounseling? You know, did the parents who went back to their hometowns, did you find them using that?
Absolutely. So we, in fact, had launched this system of teleconsulting in Tata Memorial Hospital, and that has worked very well. And there are a whole lot of families who have been emailing us, calling us and scheduling their appointments. And we're making sure that, you know, they don't have to travel all the way for their follow-ups. We've been making sure that if they can manage their blood tests there and share the reports with us, we've been able to consult with them over the phone. So yes, it's been a real boon for us to have this teleconsulting facility by the hospital.
Any child you can think of at this moment, if you talk of corona experience, so any child with any particular experience you want to share?
So I cannot really think of a specific case, but yes, we've had a lot of children who have, you know, been held up in the villages. Today in the morning, one of my colleagues was sharing with us that she had a teleconsulting with a child, and the child was happily sitting in the fields, and she could see the fresh fields at the back, and the child was smiling and hadn't come, was due for an appointment. But the parents were given a consult over the phone, and they've been advised the way forward. So children are very happy meeting their doctors online and talking to them. So that happens in the teleconsulting. The patients are always there. But the parents have been very good with WhatsApp, and they've all been sharing their reports on WhatsApp. And we've been doing a lot of follow-up with the data that they are providing, the reports they are providing on WhatsApp. So that's helped us a lot in tracking our families also.
Wonderful. In terms of impact, the work that your organization does, what I want to know is all the volunteers who you have, what is it the new things that they have learned? What is it that they're taking back from COVID? As Sanjeev ji said, that, you know, the learning of working virtual, working with in this setup is a new thing for him. So your volunteers, what is it that they've learned new, and what do they carry forward with them in the coming years?
So in fact, you know, in the last couple of months, we really missed our NGO partners and volunteers physically being present at the hospital, because we've restricted just the employees to be here. Just very few NGO representatives have been here who have been providing us with essential services. But they've all been absolutely involved and helping us from their homes. So like, you know, helping us with all the material that we've required, even the food that I mentioned, even all these, you know, protective gears, making sure that the deliveries are done on time. So we've had all these volunteers and NGO partners run around a lot for us over the months. But yes, they, just the way we have been missing them, they have been missing the children. And every now and then they reach back to us that when can we start coming back to the hospital and volunteering. So we have started, you know, with some volunteers coming in, and hopefully in another few months, everyone will be back to the hospital and the children will have all their activities again.
I think that's the best part of working with children. You know, they add more life to us. It is, I think, very, very satisfying to work with children, seeing them smile. Yes. I think that way, I think your organization has an edge over others. You know, working with children, I think, is a blessing. So wonderful. I mean, I hope that, you know, good work is done in the coming years. But, you know, as over this time, I think patients have been affected because they could not reach the hospital. So, you know, I would request if Dr. Deshpande sir can shed a little light on experience directly with patients, especially surgical oncology, if they have solid tumors, it is maybe, you know, increasing in size, the cancer is spreading, just because they cannot travel. Sir, any specific things that you felt that, you know, in terms of the kind of case you're getting?
Yeah, well, it's interesting, but people have not really approached doctors as quickly as they should during this period when everyone was really paranoid. And not only me, but I have discussed this with a lot of my colleagues, all the surgical oncologists, medical oncologists, and patients have not come for diagnosis early. So we are seeing cases which have been probably kept at bay for about a year, 6-8 months at a stretch. Today, I interestingly saw a doctor who was practicing abroad, and she's come with an advanced breast tumor, advanced, so it's coming through the skin. And I asked her, well, why didn't you come and approach somebody earlier? And she just said, well, it was the corona, so I just didn't come across to see anybody. But here is a lady doctor who spent her whole life practicing medicine, and they haven't come in early. So how can we blame people from the normal population who are so scared about COVID? And, you know, even we were scared of COVID. For example, I was affected. My whole team was affected, both here and at Breach Candy. So we had to stop our work. So it's not just that, you know, we are worried about the normal population, but even the doctors were getting affected. We were working, we were short-staffed. Our class three, class four workers, quite a lot of them had got affected. Nurses got affected. Quite a lot of doctors got affected. So all these things actually did impact work. But the truth is doctors and the hospitals have actually worked all through. So despite being short-staffed, I mean, I think one particular incident really comes to my mind to tell you how much these people have actually gone out of their way to work and quietly not appreciate as much. You know, doctors get appreciated, but I always feel as a nurses, a class three, class four, who really need to be appreciated. So I was operating once at Breach Candy and we were short-staffed. I know that. And suddenly this nurse turns up at 11 o'clock and starts washing up. So I asked her, you know, how did you manage to get to work? And she said that, well, and she came all the way from Dombivli. She just managed to make it somehow or the other to Dadar, and she was blocked there. And then one of the ward boys went on the motorcycle, picked her up and brought her. So she didn't take a day off. And she came and she washed up. And, you know, this is the type of sacrifices the health workers have actually made during this period. But yes, we are seeing patients late. Patients have approached the hospital late. I told you about this. That's huge. And she's another one who didn't come in because of COVID. We have patients whose chemotherapy was interrupted. You know, they stopped going to the hospital for chemotherapy. There's one patient who I know who stopped her radiation therapy. And now we are talking about not patients, people who don't have access to treatment. The people who are well off, upper middle class people. This has happened to them. So you can just imagine how it's played down in the lower ranks. You know, people who don't have access. I mean, it was so heartening to hear what Shalini was saying. You know, it's so nice to hear about all the work that's gone on with the pediatric group. These are the problems we faced.
Particularly, you know, I just want to ask you one thing is that, you know, one, as you said, those who have access to treatment, and there's a whole group, say in India, many would look up to going to Mumbai for treatment. Yeah. Many were in the middle of treatment. Many were about to go for a treatment, you know, when this COVID struck, just, you know, suddenly.
Yeah.
So do you feel that, you know, there should be more treatment centers so that people need not travel as much, but can access treatment in their local states or places? There are centers, of course, but then do we need to increase that more? Do you see it as a solution?
Yeah, I mean, there's no question. We need far more centers all over the country. And all those centers don't necessarily have to be, you know, the top of the notch. You need to have multiple centers which can follow treatments. That means basic treatment which are designed at any other center. Now you can get it on teleconsultation. And these treatments can then be carried out adequately there. So opinions can be obtained from anywhere. But there need to be more facilities. I mean, more radiation therapy machines. I think chemotherapy is very easy to give anywhere. You may not get the high-level surgical training in most centers, but at least most of the basic treatments can all be carried out. But we do have a lot of patients coming in from out of town. And even during COVID, it's quite interesting. They were the brave ones who still came down to Bombay for treatment. Some or the other, there is, I know someone who actually, when they had to travel back, they had to go by car and it took them literally nearly 48 hours to get back. And, you know, they told us all the scenes on the road and things like that. And it's quite amazing. But people do brave. But to come back to your question, yes, obviously we require far more centers than we have. Because look at our population. It's impossible. And if you travel somewhere abroad, for example, if you ever walk around the streets of London, you will see that every second and third street actually has a hospital. It may be a small hospital or a community, but they've got so many hospitals. Of course, central London, they're closing down because of costs. But the fact is, they've had so many hospitals in the olden era. So we require them.
As you mentioned, that we should make it accessible. May not be the, you know, the super specialty hospitals, but, you know, units which can at least take care of follow-ups, or you can even prevention for that matter. I mean, do you look at early diagnosis and prevention as one of the things to be boosted in the country? What is your view on that, sir?
Oh, that goes without saying. I mean, we are not going to get anywhere with treatments. If you really want to make a dent for cancer, it's got to be increased awareness and early diagnosis, which can, you know, and screening for certain things. Oral cancers, breast cancers, cervical come easily to mind. These are three. These are commonest cancers in women, breast and cervical cancers and oral cancers as a group. And also, if you actually look at the numbers, we have to become very aware that GI, the gastrointestinal cancers, especially if you take from the mouth right to the other end, they're very, very common, one of the largest group of cancers. So, yeah, I think awareness, the truth is with our population, you cannot treat this volume. It is not possible. So the only way is to bring the numbers down or to make your treatments more effective. That means you treat them at an earlier stage. So whatever treatments you have are much more effective. So they're less side effects, shorter treatments, less aggressive treatments. You know, and then, of course, you have improved survival, improved quality of life. That gives more working years to this population, which also will help our economy.
Exactly.
So, you know, that's actually, this we must stress on that, actually.
And the cost also, I think, you know, the cost for the patient also comes down when you diagnose it early. And even downstaging, you know, if especially you work with surgical oncology, if you think of solid tumors, you're talking of GI or any of it, you know, if you come in early, then the whole thing becomes easy in a lot of ways.
It becomes
of course
easy.
It's cancer, but then that's still...
You can maintain function, you can maintain quality of life, as I said. And for many of the solid tumors, for example, head and neck, it's the function which is maintained. In GIs, a lot of the functions got to be maintained. So the smaller the resections, the more the function that's maintained. And that allows your quality of life to be maintained. And that is really the whole aim of cancer treatment, frankly, is to return the individual to a normal, effective social life. And that can only be done by early diagnosis, downstaging, you know, increasing awareness. That is really the crux of the problem.
Considering that, you know, COVID has changed our life, it's going to be a lot of the new normal is going to be like this. You know, we will not be probably moving as much. I don't know. I mean, when everything will open up. So what is it that you recommend as an individual to be concerned about or look for or be a little mindful of, you know, the changes in terms of cancer, the solid tumors that you are working with? You know, how would you like your patients to reach you? At what point? And what should we do? What is your recommendation for us?
Well, I think the first point to go across is, yes, COVID's not going to go away. But, you know, if you take heart from the Spanish flu, and that's what I always think back upon, with no treatment, nothing available, it didn't kill everybody. It didn't last a lifetime. Either the virus will mutate or we will mutate. One of these two things happen and we will survive. I mean, that's the way nature of our life. Having said that, I think we must not let the fear of COVID get everyone. It's not COVID is today not anywhere killing anywhere near the numbers that we thought it would. That's one. Also, we realize that the incidence has definitely dropped. I mean, of course, the virus may mutate and come back in a big way, but even if it's around, you know, by wearing a mask, following basic things, you have to access doctors. If you have a problem, you can't sit at home, because that problem is only going to grow. You can't sweep it under the blanket. You need to just, you know, access doctors, come early, because that's how you can be treated. And that goes for every solid tumor. So if you have any problem which is not going away, let's say even for 3 or 4 weeks, it is essential to access doctors. And frankly, doctors have actually been working all through. They are accessible. It's only the fear of the patient which is preventing them to go to the doctor. And they must.
And I think we must also recognize that, as you said, all the doctors, all the support staff, nurses, I think they have been the bravest of the lot. And all the NGOs who are working in the hospitals, I think they've really braved it. Otherwise, it would not have been possible to even save the lives that have been saved in the cancers. You all have gone through COVID and then, you know, you're still working. It's amazing to see that. I mean, we don't know all the warriors, all those, but it's because of them that many have survived in the cancer time, because no one was talking cancer. What we found that at every level, it was all COVID, and as if cancer was not there.
Yeah, Dr. Roshni Chinoy has actually written a very nice little piece in the newspaper called "The Emperor Maladies Cannot Be Kept Away." I mean, you're nearly required to access it.
Sir, did you experience working with patients, teleconsulting with them? So what has been your experience with teleconsulting?
Well, I had a very frustrating day teleconsulting today when it didn't really work. So there are some good things about teleconsulting in the sense that patients who really don't need to come all the way for follow-ups, you know, especially though, I mean, you can probably, you know, sort some of them away and prevent at least some of these extra visits, especially people in Tata Memorial, people who are traveling. You know, I still remember my days in TMH and people would be traveling 2 days to come and meet us for 15, you know, for about 10 minutes and 15 minutes. And these sort of things can definitely be avoided. So when with your peripheral centers and your teleconsultations, you can decrease routine follow-up patients. Patients who have problems still require to always be seen. And one of the problems of teleconsultation has been that patients are really not happy. Over a period of time, things may change. But I have found, for example, the minute I'm more and more now accessible in hospital, and the hospitals have allowed outpatients to open. What had happened was hospitals themselves had closed the outpatients, except for certain emergencies and things. Now they've opened up. And the minute we have opened up, people actually don't want to do as much teleconsulting as they used to. So I'm seeing the change from the patient's point of view. They want to come for a physical examination. They want to meet you. And I do feel that, yes, when you actually have a patient across with a relative, I mean, the feedback that you get even from a patient's facial expressions, very often you do not get this to the same extent as when you get as on a teleconsultation. So each of it has got its advantages. I mean, decreasing patient visits to hospitals, especially from out of town. Patients' quick access. Now, it doesn't have to be a telecon, even a WhatsApp, I mean, or a WhatsApp video call. You know, patients can literally, if they're really from far away, that like I have patients from out of town, out of the country, they very often ask me, can we speak to you at this particular time? Then they do a video consultation and they decrease their visits, or if there's a problem, then they fly down straight away for their treatments. So there are definite advantages.
But if we talk of, you know, teleconsultation being the future, partially, maybe not for surgery, but generally for all consultation purposes, is it going to be valid or legal as a process of diagnosis or consultation?
Well, you see, the legal part will always follow. The lawyers will frame rules, regulations, all those. And then your corporatization of the hospital will come up with a set of things that you have to follow. So the legal side will slowly get taken care of. The problem with medicine is it's not just numbers and looking at some things. You require to have this. What we are losing is the human touch. We need the human touch, which is a healing touch. That is why this old thought process of bedside manners, how you speak to patients, the healing touch of a doctor that, you know, I have so many patients who just want to come because they want to be seen, they want to be touched, they want to be talked to as a human being, and they want to be, you know, which they don't get on the video. So maybe with the older people phasing out and the younger kids coming up, you know, new young generation, it may change. But the present generation of people, and I still feel personally that human touch doesn't go away. I mean, everybody still wants that. So to a certain extent, teleconsultation and video consultations will take place. In fact, I mean, COVID did bring it to the fore, but it was actually taking place. For a few years, I have known a lot of patients from Bombay, at least, taking opinions from abroad on video. So this sort of video consultation was going on in a small way. Mm-hmm. It's now come to the fore because of COVID and patients not being able to access the doctors. But I personally find that patients who know you and are under your treatment are not happy only with a teleconsultation. They want to come. I have patients from all over the country and all of them are just waiting for, you know, to fly down again and come. I just met a patient from Nepal. They were waiting for a year. You know, so two or three teleconsultations, but they still had to come down. It's like that. Part of it is the patient being satisfied. It's not the doctor. It's the patient satisfaction. The patient is satisfied with the teleconsultation will work. At the moment, I feel patients are not. At least not entirely.
You have talked about the patients quite a bit. I want to hear what the doctor feels like. Were you missing it? Did you want to meet the patients?
I think it's terrible work doing teleconsultation. It increases the workload phenomenally. Like today, I had a most frustrating day. I mean, either sometimes you hear the patient, sometimes the patient doesn't hear you, and you know that sort of dissatisfaction. And we always think technology is a utopia. No, technology is just something which is supposed to make our job easy. Sometimes it doesn't make our job easy. For my teleconsultations, if I have to see so many patients in one and a half hours, 2 hours, mm-hmm. 2.5 hours, my junior doctors have to do a lot of work. Uploading of reports, downloading of reports, analyzing each report, making a note mm-hmm. of each report takes hours. So very often my juniors labored for 2 hours for one of our teleconsultation sessions mm-hmm. when we see 10, 15 patients. And very often patients don't always upload their results 2 days in advance of their consultation. They do it at the time of consultation. So suddenly you're consulting, you're downloading reports, you're analyzing reports. It's not as easy as just looking at a report on the paper. That takes a few seconds. This takes minutes. Mm-hmm. And add to it the frustration of not able to, you know, when you're on teleconsultation, you get on, they are not online. You have your secretary calling them up and saying, please come online. You know, all these are very, very frustrating, very difficult situation. It's okay. Long time, I think, is going to be trying.
Yes, we have to get back to the normal. So it was wonderful knowing that. But I think the man at the center of it is someone like Mr. Parab at the Tata Memorial Hospital. I think he's the one who sees from across the country patients with all kinds of issues, as Deshpande sir said. That's one side of it. But how do you manage? How did the TMH manage all of it? Of course, starting off the crisis, and then what? How did you manage all of that?
Sanju ne bataya pehle ki hum road pe kaise kaam kar rahe the. To hamare doctor Badve sir se leke Pramesh sir tak sab log gate pe hum kaam karte the. At least 2 weeks humne bahar counter lagaye the. हमने बाजू में एक पेंडोल रखा था जो सिर्फ फॉलोअप के पेशेंट है उनको उसी पेंडोल में चेक करके इमीडिएट वापस भेजते थे. जो रेगुलर ट्रीटमेंट वाले पेशेंट है, जो न्यू पेशेंट्स है, उसको अंदर ओपीडी में उनका स्क्रीनिंग वगैरह सब होता था. तो ये 2 हफ्ता सब हमारा उधर ही काम था कि काउंटर में उधर रह के कुछ इश्यूज आ गया, सब सोशल वर्कर उधर ही मिलेगा, डॉक्टर्स उधर ही मिलेंगे, रेडियोथेरेपिस्ट उधर ही मिलेंगे, और वो फटाफट सब डिसीजन लेके हम सब काम जितना जल्दी हो सके उनको वापस भेजने की हम कोशिश करते थे. तो 15 दिन काम चलने के बाद मुझे और एक चीज का बहुत बड़ा डर था कि मेरा जो गेस्ट हाउस है जहाँ जो हमारे अंडर है, जो हमारा बांद्रा में बोर्जेस होम करके, तो वहाँ अराउंड 250 से 300 तक लोग रहते थे, उसमें पेशेंट अराउंड 100 पेशेंट्स और उसके केयर गिवर्स. तो अगर वहाँ कोविड आ गया तो मैं बोला बहुत प्रॉब्लम हो जाएगा हमें सब मैनेज करने में. तो ये डर मुझे बहुत था. मैंने बहुत लोगों को बोला कि लेकिन हम कुछ कर नहीं सकते थे कि हम क्या करेंगे अगर वहाँ कुछ रोक भी नहीं सकते कि आप इधर. तो भी हमने टेम्पररी वहाँ ये किया था, आने जाने के लिए रिस्ट्रिक्शंस लगाए थे, जो काम है वही आएगा और जो नहीं होना चाहिए था वो हो गया. रात को एक दिन मुझे 1:30 बजे कॉल आया डॉक्टर का कि बोर्जेसम का एक पेशेंट पॉजिटिव आया है, तो उसके आजू बाजू वाले उनको क्वारंटाइन करना है. वो बोले उनको अभी वहाँ जो एक सुप्रिंटेंडेंट लड़का था वो भी यंग था, 40 साल का, उसको भी उतना एक्सपीरियंस नहीं था. और मैं उसके साथ, शालिनी हमारे साथ जुड़ गई, बाद में डॉक्टर जुड़ गए. तो हमने रात को, मुझे जब 1:30 बजे कॉल आया तो मैंने बोला ठीक है मैं शिफ्टिंग के लिए चेक करता हूँ, बाद में मैंने वो लड़के को कॉल किया तो वो कल्याण में रहता था। वो बोला ठीक है सर, अभी तो सब सोए होंगे, हम सुबह 6 बजे जैसे उठेंगे तुरंत उसको शिफ्ट करेंगे। तो हमारे पास हमारे लग से एक हमारा जो रिनोवेशन चल रहा था वो फ्लोर खाली था जहाँ हमारा सब काम हो चुका था, लेकिन बीएमसी ने परमिशन नहीं दी थी इसलिए हमने चालू नहीं किया था। तो हमने पूछा हमारे पास जगह किधर है उस लड़के को कि क्या शिफ्टिंग के लिए, तो उन्होंने बोला सर हमारे पास 10 रूम है, कुछ इश्यू नहीं है, हम उनको उधर शिफ्ट करेंगे। तो हमने शुरू कर दिया। बाद में हमारे रोज यही फोर का इस रूम में, और होता कैसा था जो हमारा शेयरिंग जो रूम थे तो एक पेशेंट कोविड आता है तो उसके आजू में और 3 रूम थे, तो हर एक रूम में 2, 3 या 4 पेशेंट रहते थे। तो अगर 3-3 भी पकड़ते तो 12 लोगों को क्वारंटाइन करना पड़ता था, 12 पेशेंट उसके 2-2 अटेंडेंस, तो उनके लिए फिर जगह ढूंढो कैसे एडजस्ट करेंगे क्या करेंगे, उनका रास्ता क्लोज करो, इतना टेरिबल सब वो चल रहा था। घर में रहना भी मुझे मुश्किल था क्योंकि बार बार इतने फोन कॉल्स आते थे, मुझे मिसेज बोलते पापा घर में मत पड़, तो हॉस्पिटल में जाओ, उधर ही कुछ कर रहे हैं करो, क्योंकि इतने कॉल से उधर रहना अच्छा है कि हम डिसीजन फटाफट ले सकते थे। शालिनी और हम इन सब लोगों ने ग्रुप बनाया था, खाने के लिए हमने सब वहां बंद कर दिया था आने जाने के लिए, तो खाने के लिए वहां से लिस्ट बनती थी किसको पेशेंट को बुलाना है किसको पेशेंट को नहीं बुलाना है क्या करना है। पेशेंट तो बोलते थे नहीं हमारा ये प्रॉब्लम है हमको जाना है हमको इधर दिखाना है। तो ये वो पहले 2-3 महीने इतने इसमें गए ये बोर्जेस मैनेज करने में, पूछो मत कि कैसे मैनेज किया। अभी हम अभी सरप्राइज होते हैं कि इतना टीम, क्योंकि 2-3 महीने तक कुछ चालू नहीं हुआ था, तो कुछ लोग एम्बुलेंस करके चले गए लेकिन सब लोगों को इतना आसान नहीं था एम्बुलेंस से जाना। तो जैसे लोग थोड़े थोड़े निकलने लगे वैसे हमें स्पेस होने लगी, तो उस हिसाब से हमने बाद में हमारे जो पेशेंट हम भेजते थे हमारे जो हमारे वर्ली में हमको एक जगह मिली थी जहाँ हम पेशेंट क्वारंटाइन पे जो कोविड पेशेंट है वहां शिफ्ट करते थे, वो वापस आने के बाद उनको क्वारंटाइन करना पड़ता था। तो बोर्जेस में हमने 3 फ्लोर वैकेंट किए थे, एक कोविड पेशेंट के लिए एक क्वारंटाइन करके रखा था, एक जो निगेटिव आते हैं उनको क्वारंटाइन के लिए एक फ्लोर बनाया था। तो ये सब अरेंजमेंट किया, और जैसे पेशेंट आते थे वैसे हर एक को मैसेज जाता था चलो इसको एडजस्ट करो, इसको इधर डालो, उसको उधर डालो। तो ये चालू होने के बाद दूसरे इश्यूज हमारे हॉस्पिटल में आने लगे। जो पेशेंट हॉस्पिटल में भी हमने कोविड वार्ड बनाया था, हमारे जो सेमी प्राइवेट वार्ड थे उधर 4th और 5th फ्लोर हमने पूरा कोविड वार्ड उधर बना दिया था, जिनको थोड़े से ज्यादा कंडीशन सीरियस है उनको हम यहाँ रखते थे, जो एसिम्प्टोमेटिक है उनको हम वर्ली में भेजते थे। तो उनको होता ऐसा था कि जब पेशेंट पॉजिटिव होते तो उसके केयर गिवर भी पॉजिटिव होते थे, और केयर गिवर अगर आजू बाजू में किधर रहने वाला है तो वहां के लोग उनको इधर नहीं छोड़ते थे। तो पेशेंट इधर अकेला है, उसके अकाउंट में पैसे भरने के लिए पैसे नहीं है, हमारा हॉस्पिटल तो ट्रीटमेंट रुकवा नहीं सकता था, तो हमारे अकाउंट सब उनकी माइनस जाती थी। तो वो हमें काम शुरू हुआ कि उनका माइनस क्लियर करो, क्योंकि उसको मेडिसिन हमारे फोन आते थे वार्ड में आज 10 पेशेंट का इतना इतना माइनस है, तो पेशेंट से फोन से बात करो हम किसको पैसे दे रहे क्या दे रहे वो सब पूछताछ करके हम उसको माइनस क्लियर करना है, क्यों हमारे सिस्टम अलग अलग है। तो अकाउंट से कांटेक्ट करो, आईटी डिपार्टमेंट से कांटेक्ट करो, उनको बोलते थे चलो बाबा स्मार्ट कार्ड हम माइनस नहीं कर क्लियर नहीं कर सकते क्योंकि वो इंडिविजुअल अकाउंट है, तो वो ट्रस्ट अकाउंट में कन्वर्ट करके लो, हमने स्पेशल परमिशन लेके वो सब किया। बाद में हमारा हॉस्पिटल का फंड वंदना मैडम जैसे लोगों ने चेक दिए थे, और भी कुछ डोनर थे कि जिन्होंने हमको चेक देके रखे थे, तो वो चेक डालो किसका कितना माइनस है उस हिसाब से, मेरा डिपार्टमेंट का खुद का फंड था तो वो एडजस्ट करो। उसके बाद उस टाइम न्यू पेशेंट नहीं आ रहे थे, तो जो पेशेंट टाटा में आजू बाजू में थे वो चले नहीं गए थे, तो डॉक्टर उनको बुला बुला के सर्जरी कर रहे थे क्योंकि हमारी ओटी अवेलेबल थी, जिनको कुछ प्रॉब्लम नहीं है ऐसे पेशेंट को हम सर्जरी किया। अपने जो हमारे सर ने उस टाइम बताया था कि 500 सर्जरी हमने किया, तो ये सर्जरी ऐसे ही हुई। तो वो सर्जरी के लिए क्या होता था कि सब ट्रस्ट बंद थे, ट्रस्ट बंद होने की वजह से पैसे बाहर से मिलना मुश्किल हो गया था, तो हमें कुछ CSR फंड शालिनी मैडम ने दिए थे और किसी से आए थे, तो वो फंड से हमने सर्जरी वालों को प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व कर दी। हमने बोलते चलो सर्जरी कंज्यूमेबल के लिए क्या रिक्वायरमेंट है 25,000 है चलो हम देते हैं, तो उसका एटलीस्ट सर्जरी हो जाता था। उसके बाद दूसरे सपोर्ट से उसको पोस्ट सर्जरी हम केयर लेते थे। तो ये सब उसमें दोनों चल रहा था, कोविड भी चल रहा था ट्रीटमेंट भी चल रहा था। कोविड का तो हमने अराउंड 40 लाख का हमने माइनस और ये सब सपोर्ट किया पेशेंट को, कम से कम 150 पेशेंट को हमने इसमें सपोर्ट दिया 40 लाख्स में, जिसमें हॉस्पिटल का फंड था, CSR फंड था, डोनर्स के चेक थे, उसके बाद जो सर्जरी के लिए उसके भी हमने अराउंड 35 to 40 lakhs उसके लिए हमने ये किए दे दिए लोगों को और उनकी सर्जरी करवा दी। तो ये सब काम चल रहा था। और उसके बाद मई जून के बाद धीरे धीरे टाटा ट्रस्ट, इंडियन कैंसर सोसाइटी, ये ट्रस्ट ने काम चालू कर दिया डोनेशन हर रोज देना। लेकिन वो जो हमने सर ने बताया कि जैसे उनको रिपोर्ट ऑनलाइन करने पड़ते थे वैसे हमको ऑनलाइन एप्लीकेशंस करने पड़ते थे। मेल की कैपेसिटी कम थी लेकिन उनके डॉक्यूमेंट ज्यादा थे, तो फिर मेल की कैपेसिटी बढ़ाओ, उसको सब मेल रिपोर्ट करो। तो ये जो सब काम था वो सर बोल रहे हैं वो सही बात है कि जो हम सामने देखना है पेशेंट को पेपर्स उनके ट्रस्ट के ऑफिस में भेजना बहुत इजी बात था, लेकिन ये ऑनलाइन में बहुत काम बढ़ गया। तो ये सब अलग अलग क्राइसिस आने लगे। दूसरा, मेरे मुझे जो कलीग है उनकी केयर लेनी पड़ती थी क्योंकि वो इसके लिए हम रोटेशंस लगाए था, तो कुछ हर एक को छुट्टी देके हम काम करते थे क्योंकि एट अ टाइम सब लोग आ गए और कोई भी एक पॉजिटिव आ गए तो सब लोग अटक जाएंगे। तो इसके लिए वो हमारे हॉस्पिटल ने एक सेटिंग बनाई थी कि आप रोटेशन से काम करो और रोटेशन से काम करने की वजह से स्टाफ सेफ रहेगा। तो ये सब हम मैनेज करते, स्टाफ मैनेज करो, पेशेंट मैनेज करो, कोविड पेशेंट मैनेज करो, ये जो सब चीज चल रहा था। तो काम करने में बहुत मजा आ रहा था क्योंकि सब लोग साथ था। मैं बोल वंदना मैडम जो है, मैं देखता हूँ कि हमारे पास जब डोनेशन के लाए थे तो पेशेंट को 10 सवाल पूछते थे, लेकिन जब कोविड स्टार्ट हुआ मुझे हर 8 दिन के बाद 10 दिन के बाद चेक भेजते रहे। मेरे ऊपर उन्होंने जो भरोसा रखा है, हमारी टीम के ऊपर जो भरोसा रखा, मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगा कि एक कोविड में हुआ कि एक दूसरे के ऊपर भरोसा ज्यादा बढ़ गया, हम काम करने वाले लोग एक दूसरे से ज्यादा नजदीक आ गए। तो ये कुछ पॉजिटिव भी उसमें रहा, बहुत अच्छा लगा ये सब काम करते समय, क्योंकि इन लोगों का अगर सपोर्ट नहीं होता तो हम अकेले काम नहीं कर सकते, क्योंकि हर एक लोगों ने अब अपने जगह में रहकर हमें सपोर्ट किया। तो ये कोविड का पॉजिटिव भी है।
जो देशपांडे सर कह रहे थे ना, पीछे बहुत लोग काम करते हैं जिनकी कहानियां कभी सुनने को नहीं मिलती है। यू नो दिस आई थिंक इज एन अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस टू हियर कि टीएमएच में पीछे क्या चल रहा था, संजीव जी जैसे इंडिविजुअल वॉलंटियर वो क्या कर रहे थे, हाउ यू नो दे गॉट टूगेदर, शालिनी जी सभी मिलके, लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स जो हम लोगों को, बट व्हाट आई फाइंड वेरी एक्साइटिंग इन दिस पैनल इज टू हियर दिस द अदर साइड ऑफ इट। ये किसी को सुनने को नहीं मिलता है। लोग तो कंप्लेन करते रहते हैं हमेशा, ये नहीं हुआ वो नहीं हुआ, बट सब ने जो रिस्क लिया था, आई थिंक अपने कोविड का रिस्क लेकर जो दे वर सेविंग लाइव्स, वो शायद सेलिब्रेटेड ना हो इफ वी डोंट हैव अ यू नो अ प्लेटफॉर्म लाइक वी केयर एंड अ पैनल डिस्कशन लाइक दिस। शायद और भी चीजें कहने को सुनने को रह गई है, बट आई थिंक जितना भी हम लोगों ने सुना, वॉट वी कैन टेक बैक इज कोलैबोरेशंस वर्क, सब कोई साथ मिलके करें। और देशपांडे सर ने जो कहा कि ऑनलाइन कंसल्टेशन में जो है लाइफ थोड़ी सी कम है, सुनने में लगता है बहुत सिंपल और इजी बन गया, एक्चुअली इट हैज बिकम मोर कॉम्प्लेक्स। आई थिंक दैट इज आल्सो वन थिंग दैट वी गेट टू हियर, प्रोबेबली वी शुड गेट बैक टू द न्यू नॉर्मल एज सून एज पॉसिबल, एंड इट इज मोर स्टोरीज दैट विल कम अप इन द इयर्स टू कम और टाइम्स टू कम। थैंक यू एवरीवन फॉर योर टाइम, और जितना भी आप लोगों ने शेयर किया, और कहानियां रह गई होंगी जो किसी और अपॉर्चुनिटी वी विल हियर, एंड वी थिंक दैट एवरीवन अंडरस्टैंड्स द अदर साइड ऑफ इट। थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस दिस इवनिंग।
थैंक यू फॉर हैविंग
अस। थैंक यू वंदना जी और योर टीम, थैंक यू सो मच।
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर सच इंटरेस्टिंग कन्वर्सेशंस एंड सो मेनी लर्निंग्स। सो हियर गोज आवर सेशंस फॉर द थर्ड पैनल। The results, please. Okay, 83%. Cool. Sutapadi, there are a few questions if you want to check with your, ask your panel.
Yes, of course. I mean, thank you everyone for joining in. It is absolutely wonderful that we are together once again. As I said, there are a lot of questions that remained unanswered. We can't take up all the questions, but definitely to start with, again, what Parab sir said, I think it was a mammoth task that he was doing, you know, behind the scene. So one thing is that now, at this point of time, what would be your recommendation for patients who want to get treatment in TMH?
Hello.
Yes.
आवाज आ रही है? आवाज आ रही?
एकदम perfect.
Okay. अभी तो बहुत सारे चीज नॉर्मल हो रहे हैं, बहुत सारे पेशेंट्स आ रहे हैं, तो अभी ऐसा है कि दूसरे प्रॉब्लम्स में ज्यादा जनरेट हो रहे हैं कि अभी बहुत सारे लॉकडाउन की वजह से लोगों के ऑफिसेस बंद थे, कुछ कंपनीज बंद हो गई, कुछ छोटे छोटे उनके बिजनेस ऐसे चीज थे वो बंद हो गए, तो अभी प्रॉब्लम ये आ रहा है कि मैक्सिमम पेशेंट ऐसे है कि उनके लॉकडाउन की वजह से और ये सब वजह से फाइनेंशियल पोजिशन बहुत वीक हो गई है. लेकिन कैंसर ऐसा है कि जिसको हम रुकवा नहीं सकते, बाबा चलो कैंसर हो गया अभी रहने तो पैसा आने के बाद करेंगे, ऐसा कुछ कर नहीं सकते, तो उनको ट्रीटमेंट के लिए आना ही है. तो ऐसे पेशेंट आ रहे तो हम उसको जितना हो सके उतना ज्यादा सपोर्ट हमारे डॉक्टर्स हमारे फंड्स से हम कर रहे हैं. लेकिन दूसरा हमारे यहाँ इश्यू ये है कि जो हमारे पास डोनर्स थे, जो ट्रस्ट थे, जो बहुत सारे हमें सपोर्ट्स देते थे, उसमें भी थोड़ी कम आ गई है. तो हमें यह भी ज्यादा मैनेज करने में दिक्कतें आ गई, लेकिन हमने किसी को ना नहीं बोला है, क्योंकि हम जितने पेशेंट्स आ रहे उतने जितने हो सके उतना ज्यादा से ज्यादा सपोर्ट करके हम काम कर रहे. और हम मुझे मालूम है कि टाटा हॉस्पिटल में लोग जरूर मदद करेंगे, अभी लोग शुरुआत भी कर रहे हैं कि हमको ये सपोर्ट देना है, तो हम जितना सपोर्ट आ रहा है उतना सपोर्ट लेके हम ट्रीटमेंट जरूर कंप्लीट करेंगे. जो लोग आ रहे हैं उसको जरूर हम सपोर्ट करेंगे. तो ये कहा जो पहले कर देते वही अभी आगे भी करेंगे, इसमें कहा रुकावट नहीं आएगी. लेकिन मुझे आप सब लोगों को ये रिक्वेस्ट है कि अभी आप सब लोगों से भी हम उम्मीद रख रहे हैं कि हमारे आने वाले पेशेंट्स को आपकी सहायता की और सपोर्ट की जरूरत है, तो आप मुझे या मेरे डिपार्टमेंट में कभी कॉल कर सकते हैं, कभी मिल सकते हैं, कुछ इश्यू नहीं है. वंदना मैडम तो है, बाकी उनकी टीम है, तो इस सपोर्ट से ज्यादा लोगों को पहुंच के उनको सपोर्ट देंगे. अभी आयुष्मान जैसी स्कीम है, उन्होंने भी कुछ अपना बजट बढ़ाया, तो वो भी सपोर्ट ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों को देने की कोशिश कर रहे. तो ये सब आगे भी हम वैसा ही सपोर्ट रहेगा, और आप तो हमारे साथ है तो हमें कुछ कठिनाई नहीं महसूस हो रही है, यही मेरा कहना है.
तो पेशेंट्स लोगों को क्या चीजों में ध्यान देना चाहिए कि कुछ भी छोटी चीज हो वो आ जाते हैं, आप क्या ये सजेस्ट करते हैं कि वो पहले अपने लोकल जगह पे थोड़ा सा ट्रीट करा ले अर्ली स्टेज अगर हो तो, ऑल ऑफ देम सबको जो है इतना रिस्क लेके आने की जरूरत नहीं है, लगता है आपको ऐसा कुछ?
हाँ, क्या है कि अभी टाटा हॉस्पिटल की ऑल ओवर इंडिया में सब जगह बहुत सारी जगह सेंटर्स चालू हो गई है, वाराणसी है, पंजाब है, विशाखापट्टनम है या नॉर्थ ईस्ट में है. तो और दूसरा उधर एक बेनिफिट है कि अगर वहाँ वो ट्रीटमेंट करते हैं तो उस स्टेट का सपोर्ट भी उधर ही ज्यादा मिलता है, क्योंकि उस स्टेट का सपोर्ट अगर बॉम्बे में आते तो उसको मिलने में बहुत दिक्कत आती है, टाइम लगता है. लेकिन अगर समझो पेशेंट वाराणसी में काम कर रहा है तो वाराणसी गवर्नमेंट इमीडिएट उसको वहां हमारे सेंटर पे सपोर्ट देता है. तो एक चीज उनको अच्छा हो जाएगा कि उनके स्टेट का जो सपोर्ट है, अभी समझो असम गवर्नमेंट है या नॉर्थ ईस्ट के जो है, तो वहां उनको 2 लाख तक सपोर्ट उसी सेंटर में मिलता है, तो वो सपोर्ट मुंबई में मिलने में बहुत टाइम लगता है. तो एक चीज है कि उन्होंने उनके सेंटर में अगर वो ट्रीटमेंट लेंगे तो उनके लिए 2 चीज होगी, खाने पीने का जो खर्चा है, रहने का जो खर्चा है वो कम होता है, और उसी बजट में टाटा हॉस्पिटल जैसा हॉस्पिटल वहां होने की वजह से कम बजट में उसका ट्रीटमेंट होता है, एक चीज है. दूसरा चीज है कि मैं हर एक पेशेंट को या हर एक लोगों को बोलता हूँ कि आप जल्दी से जल्दी जांच करो, आप जितना जल्दी से जल्दी आप कौन से भी सेंटर में पहुंचेंगे तो वहां खर्चा बहुत कम आता है. मैं हर एक टाइम एक ब्रेस्ट का एग्जाम्पल देता हूँ. जब ब्रेस्ट पेशेंट इनिशियल फेज है, जिसको बिटलनट साइट का ट्यूमर होता है, उस ट्यूमर के जरिए अगर उस ये इनिशियल फेज कभी कभी माना जाता है, उससे भी और इनिशियल है क्योंकि मेमोग्राफी और सोनोमेमोग्राफी में पता चलता है, तो उस फेज में अगर पेशेंट हमारे पास आ रहा है तो उसका ब्रेस्ट का ट्रीटमेंट कम से कम 15-20 हज़ार में खत्म हो जाता है, उसका रहने का जो पीरियड है वो भी कम हो जाता है. तो ये सब चीज इनिशियल आने की वजह से हेड एंड नेक केसेस हो तो इनिशियल इसमें बहुत सारे पैसे बचते हैं, टाइम बचता है, ट्रीटमेंट कम लगते हैं और पेशेंट जल्दी ठीक होता है, उसके रिजल्ट अच्छे होते हैं. तो ये होना बहुत जरूरी है कि लोगों ने ये जो क्या बोलते हैं प्री कैंसर चेकअप जो है वो होना बहुत जरूरी है, जो डाउटफुल केसेस में हो या सर्टन एज के बाद हो, तो उसमें बहुत असर पड़ेगा और उसमें रिजल्ट अच्छे रहेंगे.
Wonderful. We hardly have any time for our panel because we had exceeded our time last time we were doing the discussion. I'll very quickly go to Dr. Deshpande. So do you see a change in the private sector? As Parab ji jaise unhone kaha ki TMH is doing this. What do you see in the private sector? Any change that you notice?
Hello.
Do we have Dr. Deshpande? Sir, you're on mute.
Yeah, he's
on mute. Yeah, sorry, yes. I didn't realize that. You know, so just to say that I don't think there's too much of a change. There was initially a change where patients were not approaching the hospital. That's rapidly changing, and patients have started traveling. You know, more and more patients are coming from all over the country back again. It's true that yes, whatever can be done locally should be done. But I think there are two major aspects to treatment. One is the medical treatment. The other is the logistic aspect. So you must always remember that. So patient has to be convinced about appropriate treatment locally. If the patients do not have the confidence, they are not going to stay. They will travel as soon as it becomes available. Mm-hmm. So I'm seeing that patients are coming back. Yes. And at least in oncology, we have not really seen much of a drop.
Okay. I think that's wonderful. And list of the warriors who are there, I think it's a wonderful job being done by Shalini ji and Sanjeev ji. I'm sure that the volunteers are coming back and it's going to be back to normal very, very soon. Thank you so much. It was wonderful to conduct this panel. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for sharing your experiences.